Alhamdulillah, alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen, wa salatu wa salam ala sayyidi al-mursaleen, wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min al-hammi wal-hazn, wa a'udhu bika min al-ajzi wal-kasal, wa a'udhu bika min al-jubni wal-bukhl, wa a'udhu bika min ghalabati al-dayni wa qahri al-rijal. Wa sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in, bi rahmatiki ya arhamar rahimeen. Allah has blessed us with this beautiful religion, and the greatest blessing of Allah is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he has given us for this ummah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whose life is a miraculous life, he is a miracle, and there are numerous books written on the miracles of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And one of the unique things about him was his speech, how he spoke. And if you read a book, usually in a book of 100 pages or 200 or 500 pages, they're trying to get a point across. And they have to write all those pages, the scenarios, in order to get a point across. The unique thing about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he would give you a point and he would get an entire book across with just one point. Jawami al-Kalam is one of his miracles of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where he said so little words, and yet there was so much meaning in it. Like Mawlana says, sometimes I put the ocean in a drop. We know that the drops are part of the ocean, but sometimes it's reversed. He puts the entire ocean in a drop in one line of poetry, which is, again, these are the people who took the path of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There's a beautiful hadith that Imam Muslim starts the chapter of purity, the chapter of Tahara, with this hadith. It's narrated by Imam Muslim. Also Imam Nawawi, who did a compilation of Riyadh al-Salihin, he puts that in that book from amongst the thousands and thousands of hadith that he has selected in this book of about 22,000 hadith. And then he did another book, Imam Nawawi, called the Arba'in, which he took about 40 hadith and put in a small little book, which is basically, he thought those were the essential. That if you get those 40 plus hadith, then you're set. And he chose this hadith to be part of that compilation as well. It's hadith number 23 in Arba'in. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "At-tahur shatr al-iman, walhamdulillahi tamla'u al-mizan." وسبحان الله والحمد لله تملأني أو تملأ ما بين السماء والأرض والصلاة نور والصدقة برهان والصبر ضياء والقرآن حجة لك أو عليك كل الناس يغدو فباع نفسه فمقتقها أو مبقها. This is one hadith. This is one saying of our Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. And today we're going to talk about this. What did he say? What did he give us in this one hadith? He said, "At-tuhur shatr al-iman," that purity is half of your faith. Cleanliness is half of your faith. The emphasis that he had for purity and cleanness, because ad-deen al-nadhif, this religion is pure, in the hadith the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, and paradise is also pure. We know that paradise is clean. There's no filth in paradise. People don't even go to the bathroom in paradise. It's pure. And he said, nobody will enter paradise except that they're pure. In other words, you have to be pure physically first. And this part of it, majority of our scholars, they say, this is for the purity, for the tahara that we do for the prayer. That we purify ourselves physically to stand in front of Allah. This is an act of worship. Wudu is not a prerequisite to the prayer alone. People think, oh, I just have to make wudu because it's a prerequisite for my salah. No, wudu is an act of worship for the believers. And you get a reward for your wudu, whether you pray or not. Even if we do wudu before we go to sleep, and that's not the wudu of Isha. That's a separate wudu after Isha. You make a wudu for going to sleep. And that's how the awliya, they all slept with going to the bed and complete the set of tahara and purity. Because Allah loves those who, at the end, we say, "Inna Allah yuhibbu at-tawwabin wa yuhibbu al-mutatahhirin." Allah loves those who make tawbah and those who purify themselves, which is the same thing. Tawbah is a purification from spiritual sins. You turn to Allah, and when you come across with at-tawwab, because Allah's name is at-tawwab, He's the one who's constantly turning towards you. And when you make tawbah, you turn toward Allah, and when the two connect, that connection happens, what happened? You get purified. Allah forgives all your sins from whatever you have done. That's why we say, "Inna Allah," Allah says, "Inna Allah yuhibbu at-tawwabin wa yuhibbu al-mutatahhirin." It means Allah loves those who are pure, spiritually and physically. Allah loves the pure. And then He says, after the beginning of this hadith, we shall tahur shatrul iman. Walhamdulillahi tamla'ul mizan. In Alhamdulillah, saying Alhamdulillah, praise be to Allah, it fills up the scale. What is the scale that He's talking about? This is the scale that on the Yawm al-Qiyamah, Allah puts our rewards and our good deeds and our bad deeds. On one side the bad deeds, on the one side the good deeds. Let's see which one outweighs it. And He says, Alhamdulillah fills up the scale. Subhanallah, some of the ulama, they say, they will take form. When you say Alhamdulillah, it actually takes form and you can weigh it on the Yawm al-Qiyamah. The mizan, Dawud alayhi salam asked the Lord of the world, he said, "Ya Allah, I want to see the mizan. What is this mizan that the sins of the human being is on one side and all the rewards of them on the other side? What kind of scale is this?" And Allah says, go in the desert, I'll show you the mizan, I'll show you the scale. So he went into the desert and Allah said, "Look, I'm going to unveil one side of this scale." And when he looked, the one side of the scale covered the entire horizon from the east to the west. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was narrating this to his Sahaba, some of them started to weep. And they said, "Oh Messenger of Allah, how could we fill this scale with our little actions?" And the Prophet said sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "If you give half a date in charity with sincerity, Allah will make it roll over. Most of you have AT&T and there's a roll over minute. I think they took it from this hadith probably. But it rolls over, doubles and doubles and doubles and doubles and doubles. He said on the Yawm al-Qiyamah, it will be the size of Mount Uhud. Half a day in charity with sincerity. It will be, he said, Alhamdulillah, saying Alhamdulillah with sincerity, it fills up the scale. Because praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is why we were created. The only one who is worthy of praise is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why He's doing all of this. To show us, look at outside, look at yourself, look at the moon, look at the sun, look at the stars, look at the seasons, look what I'm doing. And when you see it, you just gotta say, Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah. Because these are weighty words. Imam Bukhari, Rahmatullah Alif, ends his book. Now you have to know, when you're writing a massive book like Sahih al-Bukhari, what hadith do you start with? And what hadith do you end with? It's very important from the mind of the author. He ended his book by this hadith. Kalimatani, khafifatani ala lisani, thaqilatani fil mizani, habibatani ila rahmani, subhanallahi wa bihamdihi, subhanallahi al-azim. There are two words, they're very light on the tongue. It's easy to say, but they're heavy on the scale. The scale that we talked about is going to be heavy on that scale. And they're beloved to Ar-Rahman, they're beloved to Allah. What are these two words? Saying, subhanallahi wa bihamdihi, subhanallahi al-azim. Just praising and glorifying Allah. That's what we were created for, to praise Allah, to glorify Him. He is the only one who's worthy of praise and glorification. Jalla sha'nahu. And then he said, "Well, subhanallah walhamdulillah." That saying subhanallah walhamdulillah, there's two. If you say that, what does it do? It fills up what's between the heaven and the earth. La ilaha illallah. Just saying subhanallah walhamdulillah, it fills up us between the heavens and the earth. The hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, everything that you see with the human eyes, everything that you see in comparison to the first heaven is like a wing thrown in a vast desert. All of this, the sun and the moon and the stars and the earth and the planets, in comparison to the first sky, it's like a wing thrown in a vast desert. And all of the first heaven with this world, compared to the second heaven, is like a wing thrown in a vast desert. And on and on and on and on. And then he said, from the first heaven to the seventh heaven, all of it in comparison to the arsh of Allah, is like a wing thrown in a vast desert. Subhanallah. Walhamdulillah fills up what's between the heavens and the earth. You think these are insignificant words? Is that when we say subhanallah? There's a cosmic shift that happens in the creation of God when somebody says subhanallah, alhamdulillah. A tree is planted for you in paradise, in your backyard, in paradise, by the angels. Every time we say subhanallah, every time we say alhamdulillah. These are powerful words. To remember Allah, ana jalisu man dhakarani. I am sitting with the one who remembers me. It's hadith qudsi. I'm sitting with the one who remembers me. Allah is sitting with the one who remembers him. Subhanallah. How could you go wrong when you remember Allah? Because he's with you. And you can't go wrong when Allah is with you. Jalla shanu. And then he said, as-salatu nur. Prayer is light. What is light? Light is purity, it's still light. Prayer is light. Again, we're going to the same thing, it's purity. You purify yourself physically by making wudu. Then you polish your heart with dhikr of Allah. Imam al-Dasuqi said that everything rusts, according to the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, kulli shayin yasta. Everything rusts, and the heart of the human being rusts. And he said, what removes the rust from the heart is dhikr of Allah. Ya hayyu ya qayyum. He said, removes the rust from the heart of the human being. So you polish it with the dhikr of Allah, and then the light of the prayer comes in. Illuminates it. The light of the prayer. And this is the light on the Yawm al-Qiyamah. How would we be recognized? The believers from the light of wudu in our hands, in our faces, and in our feet. In the light of the prayer in all of our bodies. In the light of the Quran, the crown that's on the head of the Huffaz. These are the things that we're going to be recognized by. We'll be illuminating people who are standing on the prayer. You know what we look at the night star. If you go camping and we go in the desert, you can see the night star is so amazing and beautiful. You know what the angels look at? One of the Salihin said, he said, the angels, they look down. And they look at the earth. Because it's like the night star. When people are standing in Qiyam al-Layl, in the night prayer, they're illuminating like stars. And that's the light that's going to come in the grave and illuminate our graves. That's the light that's going to come on the Yawm al-Qiyamah and make us illuminate the light of the prayer. The light of the prayer. Salah is not a simple thing. The reason why he used this word nur for Salah is because prayer was prescribed in the presence of God on the night of Isra and Miraj. Everything else was prescribed on the earth. Came down, revelation came down. But for prayer, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was taken on the night of Isra and Miraj in the divine presence. He said five times a day prayer is mandatory, and it's light. It's nur. It will illuminate your heart. It will illuminate every single cell of our body. If we pray, but not the prayer that we go all around the world and not on the prayer world. We're anywhere but except with Allah. And then he said, وَالصَّدَقَةُ burhan. And charity, sadaqah, is a proof. SubhanAllah, what a beautiful. Look at the wording of this hadith. صَدَقَةُ burhan. Sadaqah, from sidq, truthfulness. Sadaqah shows you truthfulness of the religion. You know why? Because it's hard to give out, number one. Money, wealth is attached to people. But when you give out, the number one thing is tawakkul. You have trust in Allah. وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ And they spend from what Allah has given them. Well, where do we get the money from? Where do we get the wealth from? We get it from Allah. So when we spend it back, we have complete trust that this is from Allah. Allah gave me, I'll spend it back on the way of Allah, and Allah will replace it for me. Because charity does not diminish wealth, according to the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. And that's the tawakkul of people who give sadaqah. And it's a proof, because all of those people that you help in your lifetime, they will all come on the court of law, when God is the judge. And they will say, bring your proof. And they will all come and say, he gave me $10 when I was in need. He gave me a dollar when I was in need. He clothed me. He fed me when I was in need, Ya Allah. I am the proof number 100. I'm proof number 76. All your proof will stand in the court of law on the Yawm al-Qiyamah. All these poor people that you have helped, when you give sadaqah, there will be a proof for you on the Yawm al-Qiyamah. And there are proof for you in the dunya, for your deen, for your iman. And then he says, وَصَبْرُ الْدِيَانِ And patience is illumination. Now patience is an interesting thing. There's 99 names of Allah. If you read the 99 names, you have to read 98 names in order to get to As-Sabur. The last one, Allah has put As-Sabur. You have to be patient to get there. But if you're patient, sabr is like the sun. The sun, it's burning. It's burning, but what happens when you burn? You give out light. You illuminate. It's burning. It's hot. It's hard. Yes, being patient is hard. But if you're patient, you would never, you have never seen, I guarantee you, in your life, your parents, your grandparents, you have never seen a person who's patient who's astray. Because of إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الصَّابِرِينَ Allah is with the patient one. Allah is with the patient one. How could they go astray? It's a Quranic promise. Inna Allah ma'a sabirin. Allah is with the patient one. And patience is at the first sadama when it happens, when things happen. You know, you can't say I'm patient. You know, my father died 10 years ago. Alhamdulillah, I'm patient now. No, were you patient at the time of death? Or did you lose it and start fighting with God? You know, I lost my business a few years ago. I'm okay now, alhamdulillah, I'm patient. Were you patient when you lost your business? When you were struggling? That at the first, when it happens, that's patient. And then he says, وَالْقُرْآنُ حُجَّةٌ لَكَ أَوْ عَلَيْكَ And the Qur'an is an argument, either for you or against you. Either for you or against you. You can't read the Qur'an and act against it. You can't read Surah Al-Hujurat and then go home and backbite. You can't read Surah Al-Hujurat and then go home and be suspicious of other people. Because it says, do not be suspicious. Do not backbite. Do not talk about other people. These are, then the Quran is going to stand. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, on the Yawm Al-Qiyamah, the Quran will come. Led by Surah Al-Baqarah, then Ali Imran, all the whole Quran will come like an army. And they will stand there and they will testify against us or for us. And it would say, you know what? He read the Quran and he behaved like the Quran. What was the characteristic of the Prophet? When they asked Sayyidina Aisha. They went to Sayyidina Aisha and the Sahaba said, what was the khuluq, the characteristic of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? You know his outside, you know his inside. She said, he was the Quran walking. That's the characteristics of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was the Quran walking. That Quran is going to be a hujjah, either against us or for us. And then he ends it. He says, "Kullu an-nas yaghdu, fabai nafsuhu, famuqtiqaha aw muqbiqaha." Everyone, every human being, goes out in the morning, and they're a vendor of their own soul. You know, you go to these shows like the play. The fairgrounds, and they have all these vendors, right? And everybody's trying to sell things. He says, every human being is a vendor. And every morning they go out and they're selling, they make bay'ah. This is a chapter called chapter of bay'ah in Sharia, buying and selling. They make a transaction, they sell their souls. That's what they do, every human being, every morning. Either they free it or they destroy it. And every day, that's the story of our lives. Either we destroy ourselves or we free ourselves. Those who go with this criteria that the Prophet gave us, the purity, the prayer, the sadaqah, this is how the Sahaba lived. They did most of these stuff before Fajr, like Sayyidina Abu Bakr. He went to the graveyard, he gave charity, he visited a sick person, he did all of that. Then he came to Fajr prayer. And we don't do that in a month. People don't do that in a year. They don't visit a sick person in a year. They know about it, but who cares? He's sick and I'm not sick. He's not close to me. These are, he has given us, wallahi, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has given us step by step how to enter paradise. And if we don't take it, we take the mantle and throw it, you know, I'm not going to read this. Then it's not, you know, it's our fault. We destroy ourselves. Everyone will go out in the morning, either free themselves or destroy themselves. That's what that's me. Not at night, because at night you go to sleep. And sleep, you know, is the little brother of death. Right? According to the hadith. It's like a form of death because you go unconscious. And some people don't wake up from the sleep. But when you get up in the morning, you have another chance to start your day. You have another chance. That's why Imam Ghazali says that the three boxes in the hadith, there are three boxes that are brought in front of every human being on the Yawm al-Qiyamah. And when they open the first box, they see it's such a beautiful scent that they say, if this scent goes to the people of paradise, goes to the people of fire, they'll forget about the punishment of fire. That's how beautiful this scent is. Pleasant. And the person says, what is this? He goes, this is your good action. What you did, the good things you did, good action in the time you were obedient to Allah. They open the second box, it's such a foul smell that the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if this smell goes to paradise, people of paradise will forget about the enjoyment and blessing of paradise. That's how foul and bad it is. See, what is this? This is the box of your bad action when you were in a state of disobedience to Allah. And they open a third box, it's empty. And the man says, what is this box? He says, this is the box of nothing. When you wasted those precious moments of life and did nothing, you wouldn't see the ghafla. And the man says, give me time back. Let me go back, ya Allah. Wallahi, I promise I'll change that box to good sins. I'll fill this up with good deeds. Too late. Can't go back. Too late. But Imam Ghazali said, those boxes are for every hour of our life. There's going to be a box brought in. You remember that day? Monday, 8 a.m. Here's your box. Monday, 10 a.m., here's your box. For every hour of your life, the things that you did is going to be those three boxes. Either good, bad, or just empty. That's what it is. So we are the merchant, we sell, and the reward is in that box. The result of what we do in the morning is going to be in those boxes, one of those three boxes. I'll put a qawli ala stuff. Alhamdulillah, alhamdulillah, rabbil alameen, salatu wa salam ala sayyidil mursaleen wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'een, bi rahmatika ya arhamar rahimeen. The greatest gift is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is one hadith. All of this we talked about in the past 20 minutes, 25 minutes, is one hadith that's maybe a line or two. How much has he given us? And how much have we taken from what he has given us? On the Yawm al-Qiyamah, we cannot go to him and say, well, you didn't tell us about this. You didn't tell us about that. You didn't tell us about this. All of the things that you will see on that day, when the reality, all the actions of us, when it takes the form, because right now, we say something, you know, sin has a bad smell. Some of the awliya say, even the awliya, they can even smell sin. When somebody becomes sinful, they can smell. The angels, they run away from sinners because they smell so bad. But somebody might laugh, oh, how could sin smell? But that is the reality on the fourth dimension. When you cross over to the other side, then you would smell it. It's like, subhanAllah, hawlallah, what did I do with my life? But we cannot stand in front of Allah and His Messenger and say, well, there was nothing in the Quran about this. Oh, you didn't. Everything was there. You didn't read it. You didn't listen. You didn't do it. Everything was there. One hadith, wallahi, if we do practice one hadith, hadith 23, Arba'in al-Nawawi. This is the book that's been translated almost in every language. It's in every household. And if it's not, it's a, you know, people, there's some things should be in every house. Sheikh Muhammad al-Yaqubi, Hafiz of Allah, said, a house should not be without Shama'il of Imam Tirmidhi. A house should not be without a Shifa al-Qadiyah. There's certain things, even if you don't read it, just leave it. Maybe somebody will come and read a line or something for the barakah of the house. These are books that should be in every household. 40 hadith of Imam Nawawi. To read it, to memorize it, to practice it. The Prophet said, if you practice, read, memorize, practice 40 hadith, you'll be with me in Jannah. How easy? Easier than that? But you know, once you cross over, there's no coming back. Everybody would want to come back. Everybody. The angels, when they cross over the graves, the people of the grave, they will shout out to the angel. The angels, they say, what do you want? Can we go back? That's all they want. Can we go back? No. Iqbal says, is khak ko hidayat de bawla, us khak mein milne se pehle. Ya Allah, give me guidance while I'm on the earth. Before I'm in the earth. Because in the earth, too late. It's only hisab, no action. On the earth, it's action and no hisab. Allah is just leaving the account. Ask for forgiveness, istighfar. Praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Oh, you're driving half an hour to work. How many times is subhanallah, alhamdulillah? Just think about it, all of us. When we pray, we should prolong our prayer. You know, wallahi, I'm telling myself. We should prolong our prayer, maybe 5 seconds each for each movement. 3 seconds for each movement. How much of a difference does it make to us? But how much of a difference it would make to that night that Allah is going to give us? How amazing that night is going to be in the grave when we prolong it by 3 seconds. Our rukus and our sajdas and our standing and our reading. Just prolong those. It's not wudu. Just spend like 20 seconds extra on the wudu. The Prophet ﷺ said, he said, when you make wudu and you pour water in your hand, as the waters are dripping, all your sins that you have done with your hand, they're all falling with the water. As the waters are falling from your face when you wash it, all the sins of the face are falling down. As the water is falling from your feet, sins of the feet falls. And he said, if somebody lives by a river and he washes himself 5 times a day in that pure water of river, will he be dirty? He said, oh, Messenger of Allah, how could he be dirty? He said, that's how it is with wudu. You make wudu 5 times a day, Allah removes all the sins and you're pure. It's a beautiful religion. It's a pure religion. It's a clean religion. Wallahi, we should be exemplars. But unfortunately, you go from Mecca to Medina, there's not a bathroom you can go. Single bathroom that you can go, and you can take somebody who became Muslim to make wudu because of the dirtiness. And this is the state of the Muslims. But we shouldn't, I'm not pointing any fingers, but the Mecca and Medina represent us. Because it's only Muslims there. We can't blame it on the kuffar. It's all Muslims. Whether they're from Indonesia, Malaysia, Afghanistan, Pakistan, India, America, it's Muslims. It's us. And we can't change Mecca and Medina road, the bathrooms, until we change ourselves. And it starts at home. It starts here. The purity starts here. The purity of the body, the purity of polishing the heart, because that's the most important thing. And then the illumination, that light that comes with the prayer. And those are the steps. Step by step, you're there, inshallah. May Allah make us from amongst those people who are pure, physically and spiritually, and we enter paradise instead of purity. We'll be with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And all the salihin, and all the prophets, and the shuhada, and the siddiqin, inshallah. Alhamdulillah, alhamdulillah, astaghfirullah, wa astaghfirullah, wa na'udhu billahi min shururi anfusina, wa min sayyiati a'malina, man yahdihi Allah fala mudilla lahu, wa man yudlil fala hadiya lahu. Wa ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lahu, wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluhu, arsalahu bil huda bashiran wa nadhiran. Qala Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fi al-Qur'an al-Majid, inna Allaha wa malaikatahu yusalluna 'ala an-nabi, ya ayyuha alladhina amanu sallu 'alayhi wa sallimu taslima, Allahumma salli 'ala sayyidina Muhammadin 'abdika wa rasulika an-nabi.
آله وصحبه من برحمتك يا رب العالمين. وقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أرحم أمتي بأمتي أبو بكر وأشهدهم في أمر الله عمر وأصدقهم حيان عثمان وأقدامهم علي وفاطمة سيدة نساء أهل الجنة وحسن وحسين سيدة شباب أهل الجنة وحمزة أصد الله وأصد الرسول خير القرون خير ثم الذين يلونهم ثم الذين يلونهم إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان بإيتاء ذي القربى.